I would now like to request Dr. Archana Srivastav, Director, Balaji Institute of Modern Management, to welcome our guest with a bouquet.
We welcome Mr. K.A. Narayan, President HR, Raymonds Ltd, and as well as our alumni, Sameeksha Bedekar, for this convention. I would now like to invite Student Manager Divya Momaya to introduce the guest.
Good afternoon, everyone. Desire is the key to motivation, but it's determination and commitment to an unrelenting pursuit of your goal, a commitment to excellence that will enable you to attain the success you seek. I, Divya Momaya, Student Manager, BIMM, feel privileged and elated to introduce to you Mr. K.A. Narayan, President, Human Resources, Raymond Group. Mr. Narayan has done his post-graduation in commerce, law, and personal management, and has also attended an executive development program of Harvard Business School. Sir has over 32 years of experience in the field of human resources. Prior to Raymond, he was President, Corporate Human Resources and Legal for Wockhardt Limited. He worked with Wockhardt for 19 years, joining the company as manager personnel and rose to become the President for Global HR. During his stint in Wockhardt, he handled various facets of HR, IR, and legal, and was very closely associated with the globalization as well as various acquisitions in India and abroad. It is also a pleasure to state that Mr. Narayan has been a recipient of several industry awards, including the Raspic Award for Talent Management, Outstanding Wockhardian Award, Amity Award for Outstanding HR Contributions. He has been a speaker in various industry forums and is a member of various councils of industry associations like Employers Federation of India, Bombay Chamber of Commerce and Industry, OPPI, and Confederation of Indian Industry, and is on the executive committee of Bombay Management Association. So, it's our honor to have you here on our campus. Without further ado, I request Mr. Narayan to share his words of wisdom. Thank you.
So a very good afternoon to all of you. It's really a pleasure to be here with such a young group of students. I must really thank Professor Bala to have invited me here. So he's been telling me for quite some time to come and talk to all of you, and I think there's always a time and place for everything. So I think it's a great occasion to come and talk to such a young group of students. Let me start with the topic today. Now, we are supposed to be talking about the challenges in the business environment. That's what I'm supposed to talk to you. Now, this whole concept of challenges sometimes is very confusing, and I don't know how to really relate to this word challenges in the business environment. And let me tell you why I'm saying this. If you really look at the whole industry today, and when I talk to my people in business, they are telling me that there is recession, people are not buying anything, there is so much of a shortage of money, and consumer demand is a big problem. But I was wondering over this weekend, I'm sure all of you know, Kabali released. Yeah. And on day one, this movie got a turnover of something like 50 crores. Yeah. So today, I read a news which said that it is going to be some 600 crores going to gross. So where is recession? Yeah. So one man who is supposedly a brand has created such a big image for himself that he's challenged everything else. And a week before that, everybody said Sultan is a great blockbuster. Yeah, and overnight, now that has faded somewhere. So this whole word challenges is, in my view, is a complete misnomer. And there is nothing called a universal world called challenges, but it has to do with what an individual or a person is able to create and look at what's the opportunity in front of him. So that's the kind of topic that I would like to touch upon. And therefore, but having said that, I don't want to say that everything is completely rosy and green. So we'll talk about some of the issues that are there before us today. And as students, I'm sure that you will try and relate with some of the issues that I'm going to talk about. So let me start with this challenge. Yeah, the harder the conflict, the more glorious is the triumph. So that's what I said, you know, when one individual has suddenly changed the paradigm in the film industry. So that's the kind of a perspective that I want to create here. So all of you have heard this term, and I think it has become so common these days. It's very used very loosely, VUCA. Yeah? And I'm sure many of you know about VUCA, what it, where it's coming from and what's the background. But just to tell you that this is basically come from the US Army. Yeah, and that's where this word was coined. Now, what does that mean? V stands for volatility, U stands for uncertainty, C stands for complexity, and A stands for ambiguity. So volatility is about the rate of change. And uncertainty is unclear about the present situation and the future outcomes. Complexity is about multiplicity of key decision factors, and ambiguity is lack of clarity about the meaning of an event. So this is what is the way VUCA is today. And what I want to touch upon here is we are living today in a VUCA world. So therefore, I will try and see how we are going to cope with this VUCA world. That has got very deep implications for business today. Yeah, so we will see how. So look at volatility. Yeah, so we all know how volatile the environment is. There is complete extremism and violence across the world, which has suddenly become such a big monster that the entire world is grappling with it. Every day you hear some news or the other. Yeah, and no country is spared. Even US, which is such a powerful country today, is shivering every day if there is some attack somewhere. Yeah, you saw attacks in France, you saw attacks in Germany, you saw things happening in Italy, so, and is there in Bangladesh, which is a Muslim country itself. So no country is spared, and there is complete terrorism that is ruling the country, ruling the world today. And ISIS has become such a terror that the whole world is paralyzed. So the other aspect of volatility, therefore, while terror is on one side, you also look at how the whole world is revolving around the US economy. Anything happens in US has got an impact across the world. So look at what's happening there. Every country, every day morning, you wake up and see whether the Fed is trying to reduce the rate or not. And if that happens, the dollar goes up or down, and the whole world is suddenly goes into a spin. suddenly there is election in US and this Trump is all over the place, yeah, creating complete chaos. And nobody knows what will happen if he comes and gets elected. So that's the kind of volatility we are living in today. You look at 6 months back, you know, we all were told that this whole crisis in Greece is going to impact the whole world. Yeah, and it was such a serious kind of a thing that everybody was worried what will happen to Greece. And suddenly you find that there is a bigger problem in China, which was supposedly one of the major players in the world. So suddenly China has disintegrated. Yeah, and even before we've forgotten China, there is Brexit. Yeah, and the whole world today is now looking at what is going to happen to Brexit. So what is Brexit? Britain wants to exit from the European Union. Yeah, and there was a referendum in UK on whether they should exit or not. The majority of the people voted saying that we should exit. And the next day after elections, the research showed that all those who voted did not even know what they voted for. So there was so much on the internet, people were trying to find out what is Brexit, even though they voted for Britain to exit. Yeah? So this is where the whole world is going into a spin. And that's what I mean by the volatility that is going on. Look at how this whole situation is creating this whole geopolitical instability. Now, we never know which way the countries will align and what will happen between the countries. So if Britain exits, then the rest of the Europe will be together, or some other country will also want to exit, or some other countries want to come in. Now, Ireland is also debating on whether they want to be part of Europe, part of the EU or not. Yeah, so there is so much of geopolitical realignment that's happening. Countries come together, or should all the Christian countries come together? So there is so much chaos that is going on, and this is going to have a serious implication for the whole world. The migrant crisis, suddenly the whole of East Europe has gone bankrupt, starting from the whole of Russia. And everybody is migrating. So there are, because of the Syria crisis, people entered into some of the European countries, and they are all refugees. So nobody can refuse. So they have entered into all kinds of European countries today, and there is so much of migrant crisis that the world is not able to cope with this. The entire Europe is full of migrants, and they don't know what to do with it. And look at the kind of dynamics that is going on between US and China. So both superpowers in terms of economy, suddenly you find that the whole of US economy wants to be a superpower, but China wants to be a superpower too. So therefore, between these two countries, there is so much of competition that's going on. And China, given that they can dump goods into the US, the US economy is dependent on China because of cheap goods, but yet they don't know, they want to be superior. So there is so much of kind of competition happening between US and China that will have a serious implication. Now look at the uncertainty, the second aspect of VUCA. So post BRICS, which is what is going to happen. So the entire emerging markets is going into a spin. Yeah? And because of this, there is a complete global meltdown. So all the countries across the world, there is a meltdown that is happening. And every day you keep finding whether the Japanese economy or the Chinese economy or the economies across the world don't know on whether their economy is strong or not, because everything is dependent and they are interdependent. So the implication of this, I want you to understand, is very, very serious, and it's created so much of uncertainty for everyone across the world. And nobody imagined that at one point of time, Gulf, which was the richest nation because of the oil reserves, and overnight you found oil going from $120 to $30. Yeah? This was an unimaginable situation. At one point of time, everybody, the US, was trying to get complete control over oil, either through Afghanistan or into Iran or into the Gulf. But overnight you realized that they came up with the shale gas, which has taken away the complete oil becoming gold to oil becoming dust. And now Gulf nations are worried. So for the first time in the world, Gulf countries are really thinking on whether they should impose income tax. Everybody used to run to Gulf because they were trying to get dollars which is without tax. And now the Gulf countries are wondering as to whether they should impose income tax. So that is the uncertainty that is prevailing across the world. And I'm sure many of you would know here that the whole climate change that is going to have an impact in the whole world, because the way the glaciers are melting, the way the global warming is happening, is going to destroy humanity sooner than what all of us thought. So therefore, there is so much of kind of chaos that is going to happen because of this whole global climate change and the global warming. And the economic impact of this climate change is going to be disastrous, because countries will have to invest significant amount to preserve their forests. They have to invest significant amount into trying to build their environmental protection methods. And therefore, this whole melting ice and accelerating sea levels are going up. So there is going to be prelay at some point of the time in our lifetime, possibly. Yeah, so that is a big, big uncertainty that is staring at us. And that has got an effect in terms of the cyclones and the El Nino that is happening across the world. So suddenly you find, when it is monsoon time, you find it is summer. When it is summer, you suddenly find it is winter, and seasons are overlapping over each other. So that is the uncertain world in which we are living. The third aspect of VUCA, which is complexity. And there I want to emphasize a little bit on how this whole brain drain is going to impact the world. And when I say brain drain, you all have been seeing that India has been a supplier of cheap labor for the whole world for many years. But suddenly you are realizing that every Indian, and many of you sitting here, would also be aspiring to land either in US or in Europe or somewhere else, because of the lure of the kind of standard of living and the money that you will make there. So when I was in US recently, I found that it is almost most of the states there is flooded with Indians, possibly because of the IT, but also because of various other reasons. And all the intellectual class from India and from other countries are all flooding to US. So there is a brain drain which is happening. And one of the biggest concerns the world is facing today is the rapidly aging workforce. So in UK today, if you want to hire labor, you don't find people because of the aging workforce. And there are people who are not willing to go and work. So UK has a challenge. So therefore, they import labor from the Eastern Europe, and that has caused the migration problem. So therefore, this whole aspect of how the complexity in the world is building up due to various dimensions is the point that I'm trying to highlight here. Now, I don't think any of you here would not be using a smart device. And I think our whole life revolves around smart devices today. And what is happening going on here? Just imagine the impact of this, how it adds to the complexity. Today, Google can predict exactly where what's going to be the season. It can predict exactly what's going to be the extent of what you are going to do next. People are trying to even imagine on how your brain will work. So that is the kind of machines that are really going to happen. And the Internet of Things, so all the devices connecting together and playing a role in our life. So that is going to add a lot of complexity. So sitting in the office, I can decide on what I want to eat today in my fridge. And that can open the fridge and it will start cooking for me. So that's the kind of technology that is going on. And of course, the IT revolution 2020 is going to be another major complexity that will happen for all of us. So during your lifetime, you can be sure that there is going to be considerable revolution faster than what you and I think today in terms of the IT and the complete shift to handle devices and everything sitting on your mobile phone is going to add considerable complexity to the business. Now the last point in VUCA is ambiguity. As we said, ambiguity is something which is as unclear as it can be. So look at what's happening in that space. Completely the new resource slump cycle which is going on. The global supply and demand factors is completely changing the world. Yeah, and suddenly because of the oil price, global commodity prices have come down. Yeah, there is so much cyber insecurity. The higher the technology, the higher the hackers. So they are trying to hack into even the Google kind of a mainframe. They are trying to hack every possible. The US defense is facing cyber insecurity and cyber espionage. So that's going to be another area of ambiguity which will impact the whole world and the whole aspect of evolving artificial intelligence. So today, this whole wearable devices that are sitting and being developed. So Google is developing a kind of a driverless car. Yeah, and imagine a kind of the Google glass that they have developed and the kind of 3D imaging that is coming up. Today, 3D printers can print organs if you want to. So they can print a shirt, they can print anything else. So that is the kind of artificial intelligence which is bringing together, connecting various devices. And if I am wearing a coat, it can tell me what's my heart rate and what's my pulse rate and what's my BP. So to that extent, the wearable technology is really being used in artificial intelligence. So therefore, what I am saying here is the VUCA world is here to stay. And therefore, the world will continue to be volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous. Now, the impact of all this is that we may have the best of computers, but there is no security. Yeah? It is challenging governments and businesses. All the governments are worried about the data that they are having. Yes, the enemies can really penetrate into your data and find out what's your plan. And that's how you find a lot of attacks, and that's how you find terrorism increasing. Yeah? So the impact of this artificial intelligence, as I was mentioning here, is going to be very, very phenomenal. And why I'm saying this is there is, on the one hand, the technology which is helping the major innovations that are happening in research. But on the other hand, this whole artificial intelligence is going to add much more complexity to our lives. So what we thought, whether in terms of your planning processes, whether in terms of your real impact in business, it is becoming so difficult while it is making life simpler. So that is the kind of impact artificial intelligence is having. But it's also providing an opportunity for more of R&D investments and public and private partnerships and the increasing technological sophistication. So I talked about the geopolitical realignment, and as a result of that, this whole US economy has started again coming back and bouncing back. So therefore, the economic resurgence in US is going to help in improved labor market. There will be a continued increase in demand, and also the whole technology and innovation is going to be much more easier. Yeah, and that's the impact that it will have. And in the emerging markets, the reform process will grow much more robustly. Yeah, and this whole aspect of oil is going to completely change the world. So that is the impact that we will see going forward. Now, what does all this mean to India? So let's now, we've seen what's happening across the world. Now let's see what's the impact of all this to us, because we are living in India. we need to understand what's the implication of all this to India. Now, this entire phenomena that's going on across the world helped India in suddenly reducing commodity prices. So Modi government was lucky. They were able to bring inflation under control, but there is a lot of contribution which oil has to the success of the Modi government in bringing inflation under control. So the real impact of that is for the corporates, we had the benefit of lowering commodity prices. Yeah, so suddenly steel became cheaper, suddenly oil became cheaper, suddenly gas became cheaper. But at the same time, there is this whole fluctuating currency. So as I mentioned earlier, because of this whole dependence on the US economy, every day morning we are worried what's the price of the US dollar. So all those businesses which are dependent on imports are now suddenly in a problem. And because the dollar is strengthening and the rupee is weakening. So that's something which is going to have a serious impact on the Indian economy. And when I look back in my life, about 20 years back, all companies and India, the belief was that you should build for global markets. Export was considered as one of the biggest kind of a strength for an organization because the Indian economy, the demand was not so robust. But suddenly now you realize that most of these global markets that we believed were really good markets are not anymore good. So European crisis, China suddenly disintegrating, US economy still trying to come out of the problems. So where is the market? Africa is completely in shambles. So if you look at some big continents today, all these markets have disappeared. So therefore, that is an impact of this whole VUCA world in India. And as I mentioned, whatever is happening in terms of the global warming and the climate change has had serious impact in India with floods in Uttarakhand, there is cyclones, there is weather change. So all of this is impacting the Indian continent here. And India has become a breeding ground for terrorism. So today, ISIS is hiring a lot of people from India. Yeah, so that has become one of the major implications of this VUCA world to India. Now let's talk about some of the challenges. Yeah, so therefore, you looked at what's happening in the world in terms of the impact of VUCA, you looked at the implications for India, and therefore, now I'm saying, look at what's happened to the whole corporate world. Yeah, and the first point that I want to touch upon here is over the last few months, I'm sure all of you would have read, this whole banks issue of non-performing assets. And while Raghuram Rajan takes all the credit for controlling inflation, but he was also sort of made the scapegoat for raising this issue of non-performing assets with the banks. So he raised this whole issue saying that most of these public sector banks are stuck with non-performing assets, and he changed the criteria. With the result, most of the banks today are sitting with huge non-performing assets and they don't know what to do with it. So if they have to write off, it is going to have a serious implication on the economy. If they say that they don't write off, then they are not able to recover the money. Corporate India has borrowed from banks in a big way and they are not able to repay that because there is no demand. Yeah, so it is all become a vicious cycle, and therefore this whole non-performing assets has paralyzed banks, and banks have stopped lending, or corporates have stopped borrowing. So either way, suddenly I find government is also, for all the good things they do, they're also on a witch hunting spree. So they're chasing corporates. So Indian corporate today is worried on what will be the next move of the government to try and come with some problem or the other. So whether you look at the Vodafone tax issue, you look at the kind of other issues that the government is chasing corporate India for. So if they do something, India Inc. is not able to decide whether they should challenge Prime Minister Modi. So that is the kind of terrorized India Inc. feels. Yeah. And again, suddenly there are so many exposes. Black money sitting in Panama leaks, and then there is the Swiss banks, and there is so much. Supreme Court is monitoring. So Supreme Court is continuously chasing everybody to try and realize all this. Now, some of them may be true, but today, Income Tax Office has become the most powerful and the most dreaded organization in this country. So they are issuing notices to everybody. Whether you pay taxes or not, you get a notice. You buy a car, you get a notice. You buy a house, you get a notice. So it is sort of becoming more and more tense. The situation is becoming very tense. Oil price fluctuations. Now suddenly oil is going back. So that is another thing which will again strengthen the commodity prices. So corruption has become a major challenge for business to deal with. While their intentions of the government are good, but yet there is a long way to go for the government to anything to try and correct this issue, because it is India has come in the list of most corrupt countries in the world. So therefore, you know, we rank only higher than Bangladesh and maybe Pakistan or something like that. So that's where we stand. So corruption is a major issue in this country. And there is so much ambiguity. Gold prices are fluctuating. Suddenly it went down. Now suddenly gold has become the most preferred investment. Yeah. And the stock market is going into a tizzy. So every day there is chaos there. And real estate is completely in a standstill. So this is what is a challenge for business in this country today. And as we speak, while there was a lot of hope and there was a lot of expectation that the Modi government will be able to accelerate this whole development of economy, at least from a corporate India point of view, I can tell you that it is a standstill. Nothing is moving. So that is really the stage in which we are all sitting today. So I just want to show you the headlines of Economic Times 2 days back. This is what it said. Corporate growth revival elusive in Q1. Early birds fall short of street expectations on sales profit growth. So for the last about at least 6 quarters, there has been no growth reported by corporates in India. And that is because of all of these factors coming together. While it is the consumers are not taking out money to spend, and at the same time there is complete paralysis as far as the corporates are concerned. So then they projected what is the trend of revenue and margin and cost. So what does all this mean for you? All this is, yeah, scary, and I know that it doesn't bother any of you, but no, I think there is some time for reflection. And I want to ask you this question. What does all this mean for you? So look at population. Yeah, more than 1 billion in this country. And what's the unemployment rate? Unemployment. It is more than 124 million people unemployed in this country. We try to look at how much of urban population is unemployed. Yeah, 135 million people unemployed. And rural is 113 million. So look at the kind of unemployment that is there. And it is something which all of you need to ponder about. On you go through all these courses, you become MBAs, but don't forget that the unemployment in this country is going up and up. Though the government has forecasted a very optimistic future, so by 2020 or 2016, they said they will bring it down to 4.8. Yeah, so there is some hope there. Having said all this, and by the year 2020, they said it will come to 4.6. So this is the promise the government has made. So having said all this, now I want to say that, you know, there is always a gloomy side of what's going on here. But let's see, is it so gloomy? And the picture that I want to present here is, while all these are factors which all of you need to keep in mind, at the back of your mind, but it does not mean that everything is over. All the point that I'm only trying to make is, we all go to Disneyland to go on a roller coaster, but here we are really living in a roller coaster world. So experience this roller coaster ride and feel the fun, but also remember that there is something which we all need to do. And so look at the opportunities. So while I talked about the challenges for the VUCA from a world point of view, and the implication for India, and also the kind of impact it is having on the corporate India, now I'm trying to present to you the kind of opportunities that are there. So the government has been very, very serious, and I think Mr. Modi and the whole team deserves all the credit for everything that they are trying to do. Yeah, and they are trying to revive the economy. It is not an easy job. After about 50 years of misrule, it is not easy to turn around a country as diverse as India, despite some of the wrong things they are doing. But there are many right things they are doing, and that's an opportunity for all of you. So there is political stability. For the first time, after so many coalition governments, and there was complete chaos as far as government and the whole world did not know whether India will ever have stability. Suddenly you find an era of stability with one government having complete majority in parliament. So that's, I think, a big opportunity for India Inc. The second, you see that the GDP is growing. So when you look at all across the world, the whole world is focused on India. What is India doing differently? Because the GDP is growing at 7% plus. Most of the countries in the world are not able to get GDP growth, but there is growth in India. So that is a positive story. Government is focused on ease of doing business. So they are trying to cut red tape. They are trying to cut all the bureaucracy. They are trying to open single windows for business to come in and do something. So therefore, they are trying to encourage business, and that is the ease of doing business. Now the Make in India campaign, I think the president is leading it himself. So he's going across the world and trying to position India as a global superpower for manufacturing. And it has caught so much of attraction for many of the global corporates across the world that is going to be a big opportunity for everybody. Yeah, India's foreign policy has suddenly changed. So he's completely changed the image of India in the eyes of most of the countries across the world. And suddenly, because of this whole geopolitical realignment and the terror that is happening in Pakistan, in Syria, and all of these coming together, and the oil price crisis, the whole world is focused on India. And they think India is an island of opportunity. So everybody is now trying to come here. So you saw the other day, Tim Cook of Apple saying that they consider India as the biggest opportunity here. You found the CEO of Google who came here and he said that they are going to invest here. Yeah, Amazon CEO Jeff was here. So he was saying that India is a land of opportunity. So all global CEOs today are looking at India as a big market. And that's the opportunity for all of you. And the Skill India movement. So as you saw, the kind of rural population unemployment rate, there is a big opportunity because of Skill India. Millions of jobs are going to be created because of the Skill India kind of campaign that's going on, where the government is trying to create a platform for people to build skills. So technical courses are being given, IT courses are being given. Government is subsidizing corporates if we are willing to invest into building skills. So the Skill India campaign is a big opportunity that is there. So another headlines from the Economic Times. It says, India is an island of calm in a choppy world. This is a Barclays CEO. Yeah. So therefore, all is not lost. What I'm saying is there is a huge opportunity. And so therefore, given where all of you are today, I think this is a real time has come for all of you to really think and do something different, given that there is so much goodness all around, despite a big VUCA that is impacting all of us. Yeah. So what do you do? So is the question. Yeah. So I don't know if all of you can read this, but let me read it. Don't wish it was easier. Don't wish it was easier. Wish you were better. Don't wish for less problems. Wish for more skills. Don't wish for less challenge. Wish for more wisdom. So that is. So how has many people disrupted, even in a time when the VUCA world is disrupting the world? So I just want to touch upon some of these examples. And I don't have to explain, I think all of you are using many of these apps day in and day out. Look at what Paytm did. They collected money from all of you and put it in their pocket. Yeah, and make you pay for what you are doing. So overnight, Paytm is sitting with tons of money in their pocket, which is belonging to you, right? Look at what Uber did. When the taxis were taking the consumers for a ride, they just provided a clean platform. Do you know Uber does not own any taxis in the world? Yeah? So look at the business model. What an innovation. Just an aggregation. And everybody is chasing Uber. Look at what Ola did. Similar kind of a model. See Zomato. I don't think any of you would not be using Zomato today. Yeah, for your dining need. Yeah. I don't have to say anything. All of you are laughing. A yoga guru completely disrupted. Hindustan Lever CEO is not sleeping. Procter & Gamble CEO is not sleeping. Yeah? They are all running for their lives. Colgate, they don't know what to do. So there is no area where Patanjali is not touched. Dal se leke, chawal se leke, oil se leke, toothpaste, shampoo. Bas, list. Lamba, chalte jao. Yeah? Yeah. And to mind you, ek paisa kharcha nahi kiya marketing mein. Koi advertisement nahi hai TV mein. Yeah? And all of you are sitting here with suit. Uske paas dhoti pehen ke kaam karte hain log. No MBAs. Very simple model. No manufacturing units. Imagine the power of imagination and the power of individual brand. It is just Baba Ramdev, that's all. That is a brand. It is Rajnikant, is a brand. That's all. So therefore, there is a way when you are confronted with challenges on how you deal with challenges. Look at this. We are not sleeping because amara kapda nahi bik raha hai. Everybody is on sale. Everybody is going to Flipkart and everybody is going to Amazon. Yeah? Suddenly you find Amazon is delivering khana also to your house. It has started in the US. So you can call Amazon and somebody will come and deliver khana to you. See the power of the platform. Yeah? And look at all of those guys. You want to dispose of your junk furniture? Quicker me dalo. Possible. So look at how things are getting disrupted. And that is the VUCA. And that is the disruption which is here to stay. And I don't think it is going to go away. There will be more and more. But the flip side of it is there are many startups which have failed. Yeah? But the thought that I'm saying here is it is time to think differently. Not necessarily say, I will have to go and join only HUL. I'll have to go and join only Raymond. I'll have to go and find a job somewhere after I become an MBA. Try and think differently. There is so much entrepreneurial opportunity today in this country, and that is because the size of the population. While I projected that 1 billion population, that's an opportunity. So look at how you can serve. So political disruptions, suddenly, whether it's Make in India, Skill India, Digital India, now the whole Google is saying every railway platform will have internet. Yeah? There was so much of hue and cry on the kind of schemes that he wanted to launch here. But that is disruption. So that's the impact of disruptions, how technology has progressed and how business models have changed. So Nandan Nilankani said that rethinking the enterprise, there is a need for disruptive business models. How judicial activism is impacting business, so I mentioned to you. Yeah, and how disruptive market, suddenly, as I said, all the export markets have disappeared. So therefore, this whole global market is going to be very different. So that is the impact of disruptions. Now I want to present a model to you. And all that I mentioned so far, if you look at what's really impacting business, and we're talking about challenges for business, so therefore, there is at one level, this whole global economy, which is creating all the kind of impact. Global warming is creating all the impact and challenges for corporate and for the country. Technology, we talked about how that is disrupting. Yeah, suddenly the whole internet, the whole world is going around internet. How terrorism is disrupting everything. But I want to focus on this aspect. And I want to say here that the most scary part of where I lose my sleep is how human conscience is causing the kind of disruptions that is happening today. So we talked about the impact of global economy, and I'm just trying to run through some of these quickly so that you don't have to wait for your lunch. So US economy is impacting business, I mentioned that. How Brexit has increased the uncertainty, how oil is creating this whole economy is going on a slump, and how millennials are losing the wage race with Gen X. Yeah, so you're getting higher salaries, but compared to the cost of living, how you're losing the race. So that is how global warming and all the implication of that. So look at the lost productivity, the damage to property and infrastructure across the world. So nobody knows where there will be cyclone, nobody knows where there will be floods, nobody knows how, whether you will get monsoon at all. There is drought all across India for the last about 2 years. And nobody knows why. And nobody is able to do anything about it because you are dependent on Mother Nature. And we have completely destroyed Mother Nature. So mass migration and security threats. So that is what's happening because of global warming. I mentioned about how technology is disrupting this business, and therefore that is the aspect which I am touching upon on various things, whether it's an Internet of Things or the artificial intelligence or this whole aspect of today Google can come and look into your bedroom, what you're doing. So that is the kind of technology. They are going to use drones to drop a pizza at your house. So that is the technology. So, you know, as corporate, we are worried on how are we going to do business and how do you quickly adapt to many of these things that are a reality today, faster than what we thought. Yeah? And therefore, this whole aspect of customer service, today you call up Amazon and you bought something from them. Next day you call up and say that I don't like this. They take it back, no questions asked. Yeah? So it's changing the paradigm of customer service. And I want to touch upon this terrorism as how that is impacting this whole business world today. So today, imagine the kind of terror that is spreading all over. So I don't know which market, whether I will be able to supply anything to that market or not, because there is so much radicalization that is going on. There is so much that is happening across the world in terms of the hindrances that terrorism has put. And that, I think, is creating a big impact. Now, this aspect I want to spend a little time, and that's human conscience. And I believe that at the end of everything, the trigger is the human conscience. So what are the eroding values? That what are the beliefs that all of us carry? So today, in the name of jihad, they say it is okay to kill is a value. They call it jihad. But they catch people who are young at the age of 10, 12, and they start brainwashing them. So they are all trained in different schools across the world. Yeah? Look at that as at the one extreme, and look at the other extreme, the most intellectual class. Many of the IT professionals are getting brainwashed because of the internet and the kind of messaging that is going there. So some of the attacks that have happened today in France or in Germany are not by ISIS, but people who have been brainwashed to believing that there is oppression that is happening to you as an individual. And it is okay to kill. So you just take a gun, go and spray bullets and feel happy about it. Yeah? So that is the beliefs and values. Ethical practices. So because of so much of kind of erosion of values, there is nothing called ethics in business today. Everybody is trying to snoop on each other. There are this whole 2G scam. I don't know how many of you know about it and you read about it. It is a document which is to be read on how corporate India was trying to spy on each other through some intermediate person who was doing all this work for them. So, like that, if you look at the coal scam, you look at the scams after scams after scams that are happening, there is complete erosion of values and ethical practices. Substance addiction. And while I don't want to talk about it, I think all of you know about what is substance addiction, yeah? Including Pokemon, yeah? Has become a substance today. The accidents which are happening because people are on Pokemon. And I read somewhere, they cross from one nation to the other using a Pokemon, from Canada to somewhere else. Yeah, because they didn't even see what is going on, where there is an immigration there. Look at the drugs, the kind of use of drugs. It has become so common. Yeah? So, substance addiction. Criminal. I mean, there are so many people who are, because of unemployment and whatever is happening, there is a big divide between the haves and the have-nots. So, therefore, there is so much that is happening. People are very, they are so bold. They are going to criminal kind of mindsets. Corruption. Now, I don't want to talk about it again. I think I mentioned it earlier. It is completely eroding the conscience of the fabric of this country. And this difference between need versus greed. Some of the best people that you can think about, yeah, and I'll name a few. With due respects to whatever their credibility is. Rajat Gupta of McKinsey, managing director, global, yeah, caught in an insider scam. Yeah. Satyam ka MD, caught in a scam. So, do these people need money? They are the people who created empires. Look at the Sahara. So where is conscience? And therefore, friends, I want to say that this angle of business is going to have a big impact on business, on the kind of future of India. And I look upon all of you with the kind of age and stage at which you are to try and reflect on this, because you have time to change India. And that's what I want to say to all of you, that this is an opportunity for all of you to do something about it. So therefore, when I look at some of the challenges for corporate India, new investments are not happening. So there is complete paralysis. As I mentioned, this whole vicious cycle of non-performing assets, banks, and then corporate India not borrowing, not investing. Slow inflow of FDI. So there is no FDI. Foreign direct investments is slowed down. Consumer demand is very poor. No intellectual property rights. Global corporations are not willing to come in here because the Supreme Court is not willing to enforce a patent. So there are multinational drug companies who are wanting to come and do research in India, but they don't do it because the moment they come out with a molecule, somebody else has copied it already and sold it at 1 rupee. Yeah? So no intellectual property rights. Infrastructure development. There is so much that one government has to do on infrastructure development, which has not happened. So therefore, because of that, there is a complete slowdown in the economy. And cybersecurity. Now this last point that I want to touch upon, radicalization of talent. Now, I worry every day on every person that I hire. And when I look at into his eyes, I don't know whether he is representing any of the terrorist organizations. And this is today a fact, because I am told that many of these organizations are planting people into corporates so that they get such a massive target to work upon. And these are people who come with all the suits and ties, come with the best brains, come with the best qualifications, and the best competence. But what they really do is try and spread this whole message of how you can radicalize the world. So, what is it that we can do? I'm saying while business will keep going and will fight, keep fighting the challenges, let's look at what is it that we need to do to change the conscience and the fabric of this country. So I'm wanting you to look at how the model should look like. So friends, I want to say that instead of keeping business at the center and trying to see how I can make money, let's move that to keeping human conscience at the center of everything we do. That's the only way for India to grow and for business to grow. If we are able to correct that, if we do our soul searching, if we do and say that each one will contribute in some way to a change movement, which will try and stop this erosion of values, we will try and fight some of these things which are going on. I think you have 600 people sitting here and the movement will start. So, the last two or three slides, I want to leave it for you to think. How would I know from where I'm hiring? So today, this is a conscience call. So as I mentioned, I all the time worry about the people that I hire. What's their background? Do they have any substance addict? Do they have any criminal records? Are they having some allegiance to some terrorist organization? And how ethical are they? Yeah. Look at the other dilemma. There is so much advancement of science, but still there is no cure for cancer. Yeah. It's a point to ponder. Why is it there is so much stress all around? Point to ponder. And what makes emotional quotient win over IQ? So are we understanding the power of emotional intelligence? Are we understanding the power of emotional quotient? and can we do something about it? I think that's an aspect which all of you should look at. Look at how life expectancy is increasing, but survival rates are going down. Yeah? So, what's the call for action? There is so much of deforestation happening because of this whole greed versus need. Yeah, people are wasting paper, people are wasting fire, people are wasting everything. So that's resulting into complete climate change and resulting into global warming. So that's something. See, look at and study the implication of the widening gap between the people who are rich and the people who are poor. What will these people who are poor do if you don't give them that kind of facility where they are able to at least fill their stomach with food? They have to resort to violence, they have to resort to all criminal activities. How do you increase this, reduce this whole corruption, yeah, and deal with this challenge? This whole loyalty, which was at one point of time we all thought is a reward, has suddenly gone for a toss. So employees believe that it is okay to just come in, leave in 6 months, they can go and join somewhere else. It's okay to switch jobs every day and chase some material benefits. So therefore, there is a need to evolve a completely new system. So I just want to close this whole presentation with this powerful quote from Eckhart Tolle, which said, "The power for creating a better future is contained in the present moment. You create a good future by creating a good present." Any questions? I know all of you are hungry, so I hope I have given enough food for thought.
Hello, sir. I am Devang Rajgur from a finance specialization, Balaji Institute of International Business. My question is, along with a fact, share prices of 9 companies rose when Smriti Irani took over post of Union Textile Minister, Raymond being a part of it along with Alok Industries and Arvind. This added value to the company, but what complexities comes into account due to such political change, or what are the political influence on such a change?
Firstly, I don't think the share price movement has anything to do with Smriti Irani being there or not.
Well, actually, Smriti Irani took over the post on 6 July. She got a post at some 9:45 around in the morning. And at 10 o'clock, the prices changed.
Yeah, so it may be a coincidence. But I don't think she knows tea of textiles. So I can't imagine why somebody would invest in the textile industry because she has become the minister. So that's aside. But I think the complexity, as I mentioned, is textile is a business which is highly manufacturing oriented and it is highly capital oriented. So today I find that the labor costs are continuously going up. Yeah, and there is no way to really reduce some of the other costs. Now commodity costs have come down, is been a good saving grace. But other than that, if you see the whole industry which is into manufacturing, all manufacturing industries are facing this problem of unviability sooner or later. So while on the one hand the Prime Minister wants all of us to invest, on the other hand costs are going up significantly. So because of this, and as I mentioned some of these factors, it is becoming a very, very complex kind of a thing to invest more money into manufacturing and provide employment.
This would be the last question.
Sir.
Thank you.
Yeah. So, surely as I mentioned earlier, India seems to be a shining star in the whole world. Particularly, as you rightly mentioned, China is disintegrating and it is becoming, while China was the cheapest, today I think India is getting a competitive edge. Not only that, I think there are a lot of measures which are gone into increasing the GDP of this country. Yeah, so I surely see that this India would be growing at a much, much faster rate in the future. Because a lot of other countries around the world are in recession. So we'll, I think that's a great positive thing that will happen to India. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Your motivating words, the harder the conflict, the more glorious is the triumph, have really struck a right chord with us. Your insightful elaboration of VUCA, which is not just a word, but a reality that we are living in. We got to know of how it is impacting the world and our own country, from fluctuating currency to growing menace of terrorism to slow FDI. But you also threw light on how India is being an island of calm in a choppy world.
I would now like to request Dr. K.K. Velluri, Director, Balaji Institute of Telecom and Management, to present our guest with a memento as a token of appreciation.